Welcome, everyone. We are so glad that you've joined us today for this 1 hour webinar on transition planning and the importance of the transition IEP. We hope that you'll find some new tips and tools to put into your transition toolbox and in working with students and youth, your own children, or as you're helping other families to advocate, whatever your role is in the process. We're going to be providing you a lot of information today, and we're so glad that you joined us. This particular presentation, we'll go over some of the basics of transition planning for your youth or students' future after high school. And we know that transition is a really big topic, and so we're going to hit some of the high points. And as you have questions, we're here for you as a support and a resource. So it's not a one-time shot. You have all of our transition team available to you should you have other questions as we go. For additional resources, you can visit our TNSTEP website, which has just a lot of resources under the transition tab. If you visit our TNSTEP YouTube channel, there's a three-part series on transition that features Joey Ellis, and that is very informational. And then also, we're going to share in the chat box with you four transition guides that we made as part of this process and working with the Parent Training Information Center, PEATC, out of Virginia, through the grant that this is funded through, which is the Rehabilitation Services Administration, or RSA. And so we hope that you will click on those, download those, and use them, and feel free to share those in any way that will be helpful to you. So throughout this presentation, we're going to refer to parents quite a bit, and we're using the term parents as really a catch-all phrase that is going to refer to the term for birth, adoptive parents, foster parents, kinship parents, grandparents, guardians, and other family members who have educational decision-making authority for the child or the youth. So we also use the term children, youth, young adults, kind of interchangeably throughout the training. Some children and youth are going to be over age 18, but IDEA uses the terms child or children to refer to children, youth, young adults, and students who are involved in the transition planning to adult life. So today, our presenters are myself, Karen Harrison. I'm the Executive Director of STEP, and I have lived experience with the transition process with my daughter, Sarah, who is now 31 years old and living her best life, as well as helping hundreds of families along the way in my more than 25 years with STEP. We also have Joey Ellis, and he is a former special education teacher. He has worked with thousands of families and youth in his over 10 years with STEP and in his previous career as a special education teacher. And then we have Ned Andrew Solomon joining us, and he works with STEP in the area of communication support and transition specialist. He is a master trainer and editor that we rely heavily on, and he previously worked for the Tennessee Council on Developmental Disabilities, and in that role, he ran the Partners in Policy Making program that you may be familiar with, and also all of their youth readiness activities. So he has a lot of professional and personal experience in this area of transition to life after high school. So just a brief overview of STEP. We have been the only federally funded Parent Training Information Center in Tennessee since 1989. And we just love collaborating with schools and agencies to help improve results for Tennessee's children and youth. And so we are excited to partner, as I said, with PEATC through the RSA. And now we are going to have a little bit of interaction.
Okay, so thank you, Karen, for the introduction. And I was just hoping that we could kind of ground things by checking in to see where you all are, how you felt when you found out you were participating in another Zoom training. If you would pick a face and put your selection number in the chat box, from joy to sleeping. Ooh, that's positive. Lots of ones and twos. It's a good crowd.
I see a six in there, though. It's okay to be on.
Six definitely has something going on. Well, we appreciate you being honest with your responses, and we know that it can be a little tired and aggravating to continue to learn through Zoom. But we are happy to do the best job we can in keeping you informed through this format. Thanks, Karen.
All right. So as you can see, we're going to be covering a lot of different topics today. So I'll give you a little bit of time to read through some of those main points. But understand that we only have about an hour to go through all of this great information. We do have a lot of different resources that we're going to be referring to as well. Also, if you have any questions throughout this presentation, if you will put that in the chat, and we will do our best to answer those questions as we move along. So really excited. We're really excited to present this information, and we hope that that you will find this informative. Okay, so what is transition planning? And when we talk about transition planning, we really want to make sure that we've got the student focus in mind. And so when we are working with our youth and helping them figure out what they want after high school, we have to really look at, are we involving that student? Are we asking them questions that allow them to not only say what they want to do, but also explore different options that they may not even know is available to them? So really, this presentation is all about helping parents, youth, and teachers and caregivers alike figure out how to involve that student and make sure that their voice is being heard. Okay, so we may have some students that, you know, students have concerns, right? And so they have concerns like, where will I live? Will I have friends? What job can I do? Who will protect me? How much say do I have in my own life? And what if something goes wrong? And it's really important to involve students in these conversations early. And the earlier we start these conversations with our youth, the less anxiety that they're likely to feel about this transition in life. As we know, transition happens throughout our lives. We transition from grade to grade. We transition from high school to post-secondary life. We transition from our post-secondary life to our career. We may transition when we move from state to state. So this is really a lot of times for our youth, the transition from high school to post-secondary life is really the first experience of a major change, right? And it can be exciting, but it can also be something that draws those concerns out. And again, the earlier we start these conversations, the easier it becomes for our youth to really process that and really have their voice be heard.
And as a parent of three now adult children with IDD, developmental disabilities, I have heard a lot of these issues. Karen and Joey and I have been throughout the state training hundreds, thousands maybe, of high school students with disabilities in the area of transition. And we play a game called the Dream Building Game, which has a number of cards in it, and they get to select the things that are most important to them from this pack of cards. Each one has an image of the card. And it's amazing how surprised we often are that some of their concerns are very similar to parent concerns, like, will my son and daughter be safe? If I'm not there, when I'm gone, what's going to happen to them? Who's going to take care of them? What kind of supports are there going to be after they graduate from high school? Are they going to drop off of that cliff that we often hear about? Who's going to pay for these services and supports? Is that going to be my responsibility? Is it going to be insurance? Is it going to be some other funding stream that's out there maybe? How much say will I have in my son or daughter's life? Once they reach the age of majority at 18, am I going to be cut off from making decisions or at least helping them make decisions that are going to have a big consequence in their life? And the exact same wording of the student and the parent concern, what happens if something goes wrong? Who's going to fix it? What do we need to rely on in order to make things work?
So how does the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, or IDEA, define transition? So the actual definition states that transition is a coordinated set of activities for a child with a disability that is designed to be within a results-oriented process that is focused on improving the academic and functional achievement of the child with a disability to facilitate the child's movement from school to post-school activities, including post-secondary education, vocational education, integrated employment, including supported employment, continuing and adult education, adult services, independent living, or community participation. So really what we're doing here is we've got to look at having the end in mind. So a student starts their educational career in kindergarten, and it's okay to start that conversation early and get some ideas and get those students thinking about, okay, what am I going to do as an adult? And so in the state of Tennessee, transition starts technically at the age of 14, but we can start that conversation earlier. Federally, transition starts at the age of 16. So again, Tennessee starts at the age of 14, really focusing in on designing a plan for that student to move from their school situation to a post-school situation. And we've got to look at more than just the student having a job, right? We've got to look at where they're going to live, how independent they're going to be living. And we've got to look at their community involvement and making sure that they have opportunities for social engagement. We've got to look at any adult services that they may need and how to access all of that. So it really is a team process. And it's a moving target. And so you may have a situation where a student really wants one particular career goal and independent living goal in the ninth grade, and then it completely changes over the course of their high school career. And that is perfectly okay. Many of us, had a dream about a job or a living experience that we're not doing right now. So our lives change, our priorities change, and our students with disabilities are no different.
And Joey, I was just going to mention that for me, the focus on the results-oriented process is really important. And that's why as families and youth, you can be asking for data, make sure that those goals and those outcomes are written so that they're very measurable, because you don't want to get to the end of this process and realize that the results that you were looking for, you didn't achieve those. And the only way to do that is through data collection and really staying on top of this and focused on it.
A little later in the presentation, Karen is going to be talking about some of the assessments that can be done to get at some of that data. As parents of children with IDD, we have heard for years about the importance of starting early. Many of us have had our children involved in early intervention services because we hope to build the brains early and start the skills learning early so that things become more natural in the time that they're needed. Joey's already talked about the fact that the transition planning in Tennessee has to start at age 14. We at STEP have always hoped that students start participating in their IEPs as early as possible. And that could look like different things. It can look like a student just coming in for a very short period of time and introducing himself or herself to the IEP team. It could go from a little bit of participation to a little more to even a point where a student is directing their own IEP, and there are trainings in Tennessee to be able to do that. But once they become 14, a transition plan becomes part of the IEP, and they must be invited. The students must be invited by the school to be encouraged to attend. If they're unable to attend for whatever reason, the school has to figure out a way to get their input, so it is part of the transition plan. As Joey said, the transition plan can change over time as wishes and desires change. And the last thing I want to mention is, I think there's one more click, Karen, is that it's good to be thinking about a diploma path as early as possible, because there will be decisions that have to be made in terms of classes, courses taken, and assessments done, and information gathered, depending on the kind of diploma that is selected. Joey's going to go into a little bit more detail about what those diploma are later on.
We have a question in the chat box from Cheryl, and talking about what areas must be addressed in the IEP transition plan. And we are going to get to that in detail, what each of those areas are. And the question is, and then what are the areas, and then how many must be addressed in the IEP? And you have to address all of them. And there's four main areas that we're going to be looking at. We're going to give some examples of that. And so if you have further questions after we go through those slides, feel free to ask those in-depth questions at that time as well.
So looking at who is involved in the transition process, and it may look a little bit different than your typical IEP meeting, because we are looking at making sure that the student is the main focus here. So IDEA, or the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, defines this. It states that it would be difficult to imagine circumstances where it would not be appropriate for a student to be at the meeting. If the student cannot attend, other methods of participating must be used. And Ned Andrew mentioned this, is that when the student is 14, if we're having a transition meeting, the student has to be at least invited. And if they are not attending, the school has to get their input in some way, shape, form, or fashion. Some other team members that may be involved could be adult service providers, particularly during that last year of school. You may have some representatives from different career options that the student is interested in. You're obviously going to still have the LEA representative, you know, which is typically your principal or your vice principal. You're going to have the parents involved. Definitely going to have the student involved. And so it's important to make sure that that student is not only attending the meeting, but is a part of that planning process and developing the transition plan. That really starts with, you know, the teachers, with the parents, and some ways that the students can get involved could be that, you know, they're actually setting the date and time of the meeting, or they may be involved in the development of the IEP itself. It may be where the student actually leads the IEP meeting itself. That's called a student-led IEP. So it's really important that the student is not only in attendance to the meeting, but they are actively involved in the process.
And one of the ways that we've had students involved when they weren't ready yet to be in the room, they can call in from another room, they can join virtually. They can join for a short period of time. Like Ned Andrews said, everybody goes around and says something positive about the student. The student tells a couple of things what they like best about school or something that they need support with. So it doesn't have to be a whole thing where the student stays in that meeting for the whole 5 hours or however many hours it might be. So think about the student's abilities and where they're at and ease them into it so it becomes something that they enjoy and they look forward to.
Mm-hmm. So this is more of a visual, but who should be at the table? So as you can see, the student really is the lead in this conversation, and that's really how it should be. Team member that I really want to point out and emphasize is the guidance counselor. This is a team member that's often left out of the IEP transition process. The guidance counselor is vitally important because they are that team member they're making sure that student is in the correct courses to ensure that we're moving towards the correct post-secondary path, whether we're moving towards the student getting a part-time or full-time job directly after high school, whether we're moving towards post-secondary, whether it be a trade school situation or whether it be junior college or a four-year college, making sure that student is getting the coursework that they need to obtain the post-secondary outcome that they're looking for. We've got transition service providers. So you may need to have a representative for vocational rehabilitation services. You may need to have a representative from an armed forces agency. You may need to have the manager of a local business that has an employment position that is available. You may need to have a manager of an apartment complex that the student is wanting to get into. So sometimes we have to think outside the box, but it's a really good idea to have those transition service providers or those local community members that can assist those students beyond high school. And obviously, again, you're going to have your LEA representative, your special education teacher, your regular education teacher, and the parent or guardian as well. The next here, what you see here is an actual transition plan from the state of Tennessee. You would be surprised at how many times we show this to our students that we work directly with, that maybe this is the first time they've actually seen a transition plan, right? And so the four main areas that are addressed in this transition plan are employment, post-secondary education and training, independent living and supported living, and community involvement. It's important that we give each one of these a name, and we give it some very specific information. So if we want that student to be employed, let's pinpoint a specific job that we are working towards here. So if the student really wants to work, this it's sewer work part-time at an animal grooming shelter or grooming business. So in this situation, that may be the case, but we've seen in some situations where some students have an employment goal that they absolutely don't want. You know, it wouldn't be a good idea for a student to be working at an animal grooming business if they are allergic to pet dander, right? Or, you know, if they really didn't want to live with their parents for the rest of their lives, then we've got to put that into the independent living situation. What are we going to do to ensure that student has the skills that they need to live independently? With community involvement, many times what I see when community involvement is the student will obtain a driver's license. Well, that's a great thing, but community involvement is really more about how is that student going to be socially connected with their peers as an adult? What are they going to do to enrich their lives and go beyond just work and home, right? So maybe we explore some options for them to get into some clubs as an adult, or you know, some sporting events or something that they like to do. And then we move on into course of study, and we'll get into that a little bit in more detail. But again, this is where it's really important for that guidance counselor to be involved to make sure that student has the courses that they need. And then it gets into some post-secondary goals, and these are goals that are happen after high school. So you see some examples of driver's education for instruction. You see examples of getting the student involved in some community experiences, some employment and post-secondary options, and different things of that nature. And then it ends with, you know, how are we making sure that the student is involved in this process? And then how are we making sure that any other agencies that need to be involved in this process are documented so that we are making sure that we've got a good plan in place.
Joey, this is one that Lisa, we can send out to the participants as well, just so you can have it in front of you, and then just look at your son or daughter's transition plan and go over that with them. Make sure that the things that are on there are things that are current and things that they are interested in doing, and that does change over time. We had a couple of slides that for some reason got skipped over, and we've had an issue with ghosting of slides. They just kind of disappear. So I'm going to go back to those very quickly and let Ned Andrew talk to you a little bit about the student voice, because this is so very important in the transition planning.
Thank you, Karen. And I wanted to say that so much of our work, especially over the last 5-6 years, has been in encouraging and supporting the student voice. And when Joey was talking about that slide where it showed the student at the head of the table, it's not always that the student leads the IEP, but it's always that the focus should be on the student IEP. And unless we start developing the ability for the student to talk about their wants and needs, and sometimes even more importantly, what they don't want, what they don't like, what they don't need, unless we can get them to give us that information, it's going to be really hard to focus the IEP and transition IEP in a very meaningful way. One of the things that we do often is we start all of our trainings with youth talking about self-advocacy. So speaking up for yourself, the importance of speaking up for yourself. And when we put it at the very beginning of our 4 or 5 hour trainings, because throughout the trainings, we give them opportunities to speak up for themselves, to come in front of the room and speak to the class that's assembled and tell them responses to questions. And when we're talking about speaking, I'm not just talking about verbal output. We're talking about communication in whatever way works for the student. We've worked with several students who are nonverbal, who can write things down, who use an augmentative communication device, who can answer or respond to simple yes, no questions in order to get to some of their choice making. So anyway, it's just super important that we start developing those skills as early as possible so the students can tell us what they want, what they need. Thanks, Karen. Along with having the student be the center of things, like that one image, or encouraging the student voice, this whole process, this transition IEP process, is a person-centered planning process, okay? So that means, yes, the parents and the adults and the teachers around the room all have some thoughts about what they would like to see for this young person's future, but the person who really has the most, or should have the most input, is the student themselves. And so one of the tools that we use that is incredibly effective, and I hope you can see this, it's called a support star. And it breaks up person-centered planning into several categories. So if you're looking at the top, you see personal strengths and assets. That's an opportunity to brag on the student, or for the student to brag on him or herself and say, I'm a hard worker. I show up on time. I get along well with people. What are those positive attributes that I have that would be appealing to others in the community and to especially to a possible employer. To the right, we go into relationship-based. Who are the people that this individual has relationships with that we can list, who can be allies, who can be support, who can help them with training or other opportunities that they encounter in their lives that might be an asset for them through this process. The next green section is around eligibility specific. So if a person has a particular disability, whether it be autism or Down syndrome, epilepsy, traumatic brain injury, there are going to be some services at the federal level or the state level, or even just an advocacy agency level that might be able to help them. There's also funding streams like the ABLE program or Social Security income that might be availed in order to make their lives a little bit easier. We talk about the community. Where are the places that this youth goes to? Where does he encounter people? Is it the movie theater? Is it the library? Is it a particular restaurant that he loves where people know him or her? So what are those places can we rely on? Is there someone who works at one of those places who might be able to mentor this youth? And the last category that gets bigger and bigger and more important all the time is what kind of technology does the youth currently have access to, or what kind of technology is out there that they might be able to use that might help them be more successful in school or in work or even in a home environment. This tool is free and readily available and can be shared with you. It's a great way to start the conversation. Thanks, Karen.
You're welcome. All right. And yes, in the chat box, we are going to be putting these links to these documents that we're talking about and some others. And Lisa also has some listed already in the documents section. All right. So now we're going to talk about transition assessments for just a moment. And these are the assessments or evaluations that help the team or the IEP team understand the student's strengths, their challenges, their preferences, their interests, their abilities, and their capabilities. So all of those things are very, very important to assess. And a lot of times the transition assessments will help students to figure out their career path, what jobs they like, whether they want to work indoors or outdoors, a job standing, a job with people. Some people like a lot of people around, and some people want a job that's not a lot of people around. They prefer that kind of thing as well. So these transition assessments will tell you a lot of things about the student and what could be available for them. Now, they must be age appropriate. So you want to be making sure that you're not giving assessments for a 16-year-old, giving them something that is based and normed for a 9-year-old. So make sure they are age appropriate. And this is important because it will identify some areas maybe that at 16 through that time they exit high school that they could be working on. We have something we use called a reality check, and it goes down through a lot of different things, and some things students have not started doing for themselves and they could be. And so that's a type of assessment as well, to see what kind of independent living skills do they already have, and if they don't have them, writing those into the transition plan and the IEP is very important. I know for my daughter, her transition assessment showed that she really loved digging in the dirt and being outside and planting things, and I thought, I must not be related to her at all, because that is so far from what I would find enjoyable. But based on that, she took greenhouse classes in school. She learned about different plants. She worked with the 4-H. And then after high school, did some growing of organic plants and made her cash money for her bling bling. So that's the whole point of all of this, is the assessments need to lead to something, or remember that results oriented piece that we're looking for. is really, really important. And then you want to make sure that you have the appropriate assessments, that they have accommodations if needed. So you don't want to give a verbal assessment to someone who is hearing impaired. You want to make sure you have accommodations if people need to break these up into smaller chunks, if they're need time to take breaks and those kind of things. So make sure that you're taking into consideration the impact of the student's disability and their special needs when you're looking at this and providing those accommodations. The entire point of this is to listen to the student's voice and the student's choice. So although there are assessments where families can give their input and what they see as well, and those are very valuable, make sure that you have plenty of transition assessments, more than one. You're not going to just do one assessment and base it on that. Do these assessments early as possible and ongoing to gather more and more information. Is one of the important things is to look at some real world opportunities. So how does a student function in a job setting? So maybe some work-based learning assessments, vocational rehabilitation will also often do work site assessments. And there are also places within the school building, if you think about it, that a student could go and people could be keeping data on how they do it, what they like about it. If we have students that are interested in mechanics, they can go to the bus garage and look at that, assist with an oil change or watch that and see, do I like how this area smells? Do I like, you know, getting my hands dirty in that? All kind, the nurse's station, all kinds of things, the cafeteria. There's almost every job kind of that you can think of in a high school that students could experience. So one of the handouts that Lisa's going to post in the box is just a community involvement handout. And it's kind of a checklist when somebody, a student is going out in the community, data is really important. So looking at, did they get their own materials together to go to this assessment? Did they check out at the office like they were supposed to? All of these things are building skills, but also assessing for the team, what are the areas you need to be working on? And it's really important for families to ask for descriptive information if you are getting back evaluation data about the student. What time of day did that happen? Where did they go? Who was supporting them? What kind of supports did they get? And I'll give you just a quick story. My daughter was doing a work-based assessment and it was going to be at the BP gas station that also has a Wendy's attached. So she was super excited about that, right? So at anything with food involved was great. And for some strange reason, she loves cleaning windows. So I happened to know that they were going to be there. So I kind of incognito put my baseball cap on and slinked in there just to watch what was happening without them seeing me. So I don't know about that. But anyway, I had to do it. And so she did the window cleaning and they're checking on their checkbox, their clipboard, you know, and I'm assuming they're saying, did that good, did wipe tables well. And then it came time for them to check if she could sweep the floor. And they gave her a push broom, which she's never seen one. And it was as big as she was, bigger than she was. And so she's trying to pull it like a regular broom, right? And then I see them make an X, Sarah can't use the broom. And I'm like, I'm holding my, you know, tongue because I want to say I'm her mother and yes, she can. But you're, you know, so get that information. When you get that back and it says they can't do something, ask about it. So, you know, maybe it was the type of broom or the type of setting or it was too bright in there. It was too loud. So all of that is stuff that once you get the information, you're going to have to process that a little bit and talk about it a little bit more. And then this is hot off the presses for Tennessee. We now have, they passed a Tennessee Code annotated law that the department has allocated funds for all 12th grade students to take optional nationally recognized career readiness assessments at no cost. And so this is a list of the assessments that you can see all the way from math, literacy, workplace skills, soft skills, getting ready to hold and keep a job, reading, work readiness, data assessments, employability skills, and workplace readiness. So these are all great, and I'm super excited about it, but just keep in mind that some of our students need more time to work on these skills, and we need to know where they are in these areas so that they can go in the plan. So any type of these assessments that you may want to have earlier than the 12th grade, it may not be this exact same assessment, but you can do ask for an assessment for workplace readiness or soft skills or those types of things as well. So kudos to Tennessee for putting this into place, and looking forward to this. You might want to talk to your IEP manager or transition specialist in your school and ask them to give you a little more information about that and get that moving.
So the next slide really discusses the individualized education plan's present level of performance, or PLEP, present levels of educational performance. So all IEPs include the present levels of academic achievement and functional performance, including assessment information and instructional needs, strengths, interests, and preferences, student and parent input. The transition plan really is no different. We've got to make sure that we've got a starting point for each of our students. So for instance, if they've got a career goal in mind, let's say that that student has a career goal to be a construction worker. So we may need to incorporate some vocabulary words that they may experience on the job site into their reading goals, right? So that they're aware of it. Or if they have an independent living goal to have their own apartment, do they understand how to budget, and do they know how to pay a bill? Or do they know how to fold laundry? Do they know how to operate some basic appliances, and do they know how to prepare a meal? And so all of these things can be addressed in an IEP to get them prepared for life after high school. And so these present levels of educational performance really do need to tie to their post-secondary goals. So if they have an educational goal to go to a four-year college, then you know, are they on track to take the proper courses that they need? If they want to be involved in a particular club, you know, what are we doing to increase their ability to interact with their peers so that they can be a part of a club moving forward? So again, those IEP goals are tied to those present levels of educational performance, and they're tied to those post-secondary goals.
And I was informed that my voice was going in and out before. I super apologize for that. I'm going to try to be better with how I hold my head. But I did want to say that if you missed anything about the support star, my contact information is at the end of this training. I'm happy to have a conversation with you about it. I've used that one-on-one with families and students for many, many times, and it's very successful. This is kind of just a review of the post-secondary goals to make sure everybody realizes the four areas that we're talking about. Living more independently. Okay, so some students are not going to want to live with their parents for the rest of their lives, and some parents are not going to want their youth to live with them for the rest of their lives. Post-secondary training and education, employment, and community involvement or engagement. Now, Tennessee has several options for education. It has a robust system of four-year colleges and universities. It has a great community college system. There are several, I think six now, post-secondary programs for students with IDD who did not graduate with a typical high school diploma. We have the Tennessee Rehabilitation Center, which provides training, and students actually go there, or youth actually go there and live for a while and learn a lot of independent living skills. You can also learn trades there. We have an incredible system called the Colleges of Applied Technology, which provide training in lots of different fields. Some of those require a high school diploma, many of them don't. And then, so outside of training and education, there are different agencies and services that can give some support around living more independently. We'll talk a little bit more about the importance of community involvement later on. Thank you. It's very important when we're talking about these post-secondary goals that Joey introduced, that these are reasonable, realistic, and measurable. So Joey gave the example of getting a driver's license. Hey, that's a great thing, but is the goal to get the driver's license or is the goal to get a job? And one of the activities is how to have a driver's license so they can drive to work. So the IEP team should be developing these goals related to all the four major goals that we talked about. And as Joey mentioned, it's going to be based on the assessments, or Karen mentioned, and the present levels of educational performance.
So what you see in this next slide here is some examples of some post-secondary goals. And those post-secondary goals really need to lead to those post-secondary outcomes. So the example here has to do with Keisha. And so it says here, Keisha will enroll at Southwest Tennessee Community College and take a business math class to improve her work-related math skills and advance her desired career goal of becoming an accountant. So first thing that this does is that we've stated a specific goal in mind for Keisha, what class she's going to be taking in order to advance that career goal of becoming the accountant. And so, you know, she's going to be in high school, potentially working on developing those math skills, but again, making sure that she's in the proper post-secondary opportunity for her and taking the proper courses. And we've directly stated that so that we know what the outcome is going to be after high school. So all of these post-secondary goals need to be able to occur after the student leaves high school. So this also states that Keisha will use an adding machine. She will create spreadsheets using money management software, and that we've got a stated accuracy goal for that as well. So that way we can keep track of how well Keisha is making progress towards that goal, and so that we can keep data to make sure that she reaches that outcome that we're looking for.
And Joey, I just kind of wanted to clarify. So the education training outcome, when you looked at that transition plan, would be those four boxes. One of them's education. And remember, right there, it says after high school. So we've had some conversations with Keisha. What she wants to do after high school is become an accountant. And you've got that she wants to enroll in this particular Tennessee Community College. And the things in the smaller box, the box off to the right, that's what she's going to do now. So those are the things that you're going to write goals about in her transition plan, in her IEP. And so you're trying to just give you an idea. We're going to give you a couple of examples how that all works together. What you want to do after high school is clearly stated, and then you have multiple steps to make sure you're getting there. Again, that results-oriented process, and those are some buzzwords that you can use as families at your meeting. I learned that this is results-oriented. Show me how we're progressing toward this outcome.
One of the things we know about Keisha is that she happens to have a physical disability. So there may be some additional services or activities that have to take place in order for her to be successful at Southwest Tennessee Community College. One of the services that's very important for students with disabilities to know about post-secondary learning and training is that there is typically a disability services office that they should be in contact with from the jump in order to make sure that there are some accommodations in place to be successful. So in this thing where one of our activities is that Keisha will visit the college at least three times so she can become familiar with the campus. She can figure out what issues might impact her in terms of accessibility, getting from class to class, getting to a class in a particular building. It may be that a class that she needs for her major is typically given on the third floor, and she'll have to work with the college probably through the Disability Services Office in order to have them conduct the class on the lower level so she can access it. This transition activity is going to take place during the school year. So she is ready and prepared and can just jump in and get ready to start learning when she goes to college. The typical people who would be involved in this are going to be Keisha, obviously, her guidance counselor, and Joey mentioned the importance of the guidance counselor before, a transition coordinator, and her VR counselor, because chances are she will be involved with vocational rehabilitation, who may be helping her with tuition or books or other support services that she might need in college. Thank you. Community involvement is huge, and it is one of the four main goals, but it's also the difference between how somebody lives their life and how somebody could be living their life. Segregated in a home environment doesn't lead to many opportunities, and so I wanted to mention a few of those opportunities, like networking for jobs. Okay, many of us did not get our jobs through presenting a resume or applying for a job in person or answering an ad in a paper. It was because we knew somebody or we found out some information through a friend. So the more that someone can network, the more people they meet who might be able to help them on their way. Volunteer opportunities, internships, they can start to figure out what it is that they're super interested in that they might want to learn more about. Having a social life, okay? You're not going to get a social life if you're segregated in your home. Having a spiritual life, a lot of people have a spiritual life as a major part of their whole life. Is this person going to be able to access a church or a temple, synagogue, whatever? They may want to be involved in advocacy activities, and they very well might want to make sure that they are registered to vote, those kinds of things. Another thing is, as parents, we're not going to live together forever. We know that. And the more that we expose our youth to other people and other circumstances and other places, the more likely they'll be set up for life when we are no longer there to support them. But the last thing I want to say about this is things happen in closed places. So we are well aware that abuse can take place in a group home, in a nursing home, in any kind of an institutional closed setting. We think that that's going to be the safest place for our son or daughter with a disability, but it might be setting them up for abuse. When you're out in the community and know people and show up at places, people start missing you. They ask questions about you. They check in on you. They want to know how you're doing. So sometimes the eyes of neighbors and the community can be a safeguard that can be a very important part of someone's life. Thank you.
So looking at, I mentioned this a little bit earlier, but the course of study, it's a part of the transition plan. And we've talked a lot about the importance of the guidance counselor being a part of the transition plan or planning process in that IEP. But the course of study really does lay out the exact courses that the student is going to need to take, not only to graduate from high school with the diploma option that they are pursuing, but also with the courses that they'll need to develop the skills that they'll need in order to obtain those post-secondary goals. It's also important to note that the course of study can change from year to year. So maybe that student needs to take a greenhouse class, but maybe that greenhouse class isn't offered when we first think that that student should take it. It may need to, that class may need to be moved to a different semester or a different year in order to make sure that that student is on track to graduate. So again, it's vitally important that we look at these courses of study at least once a year. I like to make sure that the transition team is looking at, really looking at the course of study really every semester and making sure that that student is on track, not only to graduate from high school, but also to reach their post-secondary goal. And if things need to change, then we can have that conversation in that transition plan meeting. Maybe that student's career goal changes. So, you know, maybe they had a career goal of starting their own lawn care business in the ninth grade, but now they want to work in an office setting by the 11th or 12th grade. That's okay. And so maybe we need to look at some different courses to obtain that goal. So, but again, just making sure that we've got that guidance counselor involved and making sure that we are focusing in on making sure that that student is taking the correct courses to obtain that post-secondary goal.
And Joey, I would say that often when we're reviewing transition plans, the course of study will say student will take the courses they need to get the diploma they've chosen. Mm-hmm. Well, that's too vague. It has to have what courses exactly are they going to take each year, and make sure it is very clear. So we just have a few minutes here, and we're going to wrap up with a couple more things.
Okay, the next slide here really talks about different diploma options. It's very important to make sure that that student is pursuing the diploma option that's the most rigorous available to them. So in the state of Tennessee, there are a few different options here. Karen, if you would click through that.
And Joey, we do, one of our handouts has more details on this.
Yes.
So if you want to hit, hit the highlights on this, because we only have about 4 minutes left.
Absolutely. So in the state of Tennessee, we've got the regular education diploma, which is 22 units of credit, and that student is pursuing potentially going to a four-year college or a two-year college. We've got the alternate academic diploma that's aligned to standards, but it's not a regular education diploma. We've got the occupational diploma, which has to do with developing good work skills for our students with disabilities. And then last but not least, we've got the special education diploma for our students that are not pursuing the other three that are above mentioned.
And again, more details are provided in the handout that Lisa put in the chat box.
And Joey covered this previously. It's just making sure if there is a particular interest that the student has, that there might be a representative from someone in the community who might be able to show up at the table to lend some support or even provide a reality check.
Okay, and we did have a question about, is there a list of colleges or universities and programs that work really well with students with learning disabilities? And I think we have worked successfully with all the colleges across the state. And there are, you know, as we said, the program specifically for students with intellectual and developmental disabilities. I think the main thing would be, as you would with a student without a disability, is visiting those colleges and go to the office, the
Disability Services Office.
Yes. And
sometimes they have different names.
And ask them, you know, what percentage of students with learning disabilities. They don't have to give you names, but find out those kind of things and network with some other parents as well to see where they've had success as well in those. And we don't have a specific list of which ones are more accepting or more supportive of students with disabilities.
Yeah. And it's important to know that the student needs to be able to get into the college through their, whatever the eligibility requirements are. So they don't make special allowances for a student who has a disability. They have to be eligible for that training. It's just that they can get services once they're in there. Any questions, comments, takeaways, possible first steps? I know that we have, unfortunately, run out of time, but we would love to be able to chat with you about any of these issues, topics, tools.
We've got just a couple minutes, so if you want to put any of your comments, takeaways, or questions in the chat box, we'll take these last couple of minutes. Thank you, Cheryl, for your compliments.
Do you want to go ahead and put up our contact? There we go. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Karen.
And in the presentation, you'll see all of our contact information. So you can, as you're mulling this over, you'll probably have some more questions, and we're happy to work with you through this process. Thank you, Julie and others, for your kind words. And we look forward to meeting your needs and helping you through this transition process. So please feel free to contact us.
Thank you for joining, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.